So, Steve, I really enjoyed last night's class. A lot of good conversations. What did you take from it? What was your kind of takeaway?
Yeah, week five. It's gone so fast this year, hasn't it? Well, last night we spent time where we've had this four-part model of the leader roles in agile work. And the first one was the diagnostician decider. We spent a couple of weeks on that, but last night was really a transitional night where we went from that role into the next role that we've identified, which is the agile leader as an active agent of change. And the whole notion of this one is that you've got clarity of purpose at the beginning. You've understood what it is you're going to do. You've built some alignment, and now you're anticipating how the agile project that you're about to release on the organization has how it might impact people across the organization in terms of the change that it brings about. So that was interesting last night talking about that. And we'll have more of it next week because it's the next 2 weeks that are really about that. So what stands out for you?
Well, I mean, the whole framing question, it seems simple, but it's probably the most essential part of the process, and it can be exhilarating and frustrating at the same time. A couple of the case studies where there was a clear problem that needed to be solved, it was a lot easier for the students to come up with a framing question that made sense. In the others where it wasn't quite as clear, they're struggling, and it's just the real world, right? So we want to apply real world tendencies, and even the customer in case the owners of the case study, they probably hadn't even thought it through entirely. And so it's hard when you're coming in as someone who's trying to diagnose a problem and come up with a solution. It's really hard to figure that out unless you really can drill down. And so it's painful, but I think it's a great exercise. And being flexible in the course, we've kind of shifted our timetable a little bit because we want to spend more time up front. Because the more time you spend up front getting it right, the less time you spend in the back fixing it. So, that was my real takeaway with that, and a key element of it.
Yeah, I think one of the things that was interesting last night was one of the teams had come up with actually four framing questions. In the range of things that they learned in the framing questions exercise, they saw that there's a lot of elements to it, so they needed more than one. And I thought that was really brilliant how they accounted for the different approaches that they might do, recognizing that there are different constituents that have to be served in this project, and they recognized that and built a framing question for each one of those. I thought that was great.
Yeah, and breaking it down, that's a key amount of EBITDA. We want to break a big project, and we have to ask, we ask the question, how might I, as part of the framing question. You ask, how might I, in terms of all the nuances of it. So you break it down to smaller components, and then we figure out which ones we want to address. So interesting. What else did you get gained from last night?
We've been studying the reading that we're doing with doing Agile Right, and it's a great book that we've been using. But last night we got a little bit into the issue of, and this is not necessarily in the book, but it's a theme that we have picked up on in the work that we've been doing around this thing called liberating structures, right? And what are liberating structures? Well, they're really just ordinary things that you do already in your organization that if you tweak them in an agile-like way and have an agile-like mindset for them, you can use them as leverage points to begin your agile project work. And one such area is how you meet, how organizations conduct their meetings. If you do a slight different change in the way you set up the room, how you change the dynamics of the conversation, and how you work more inclusively, you can change the way in which these structures are enabling your advancement. And so we've discovered six of those, you and I, working together on it. But our students think that they discovered a seventh last night, which I thought was fantastic, right? That there's another hidden structure, sort of the resource allocation or maybe a budgeting thing. So we've got to give some serious consideration to the prospect that it's like discovering another element in the table, right? We found another thing that if you adjust it and adapt it and make it work for you, it can actually enhance your project. And so I thought that was wonderful that the conversation last night that we discovered a seventh liberation.
We'll call it periodic table of agile in
Yes, yeah.
HR, with the whole budgeting process. And I read this in Darryl Rigby's book, Doing Agile Right, where he talked about some organizations like Dell, they look at funding more like a venture capital and they allot a little bit of seed money to a project, and if successful, they add more, and if it continues to be successful, they keep funding it. Whereas things that aren't successful, they cut the funding out. So instead of having a year-long project that doesn't achieve anything, they do it a little differently. And I thought that's like meetings. I think that's really a way to change an organization. If we can change, liberating structures are little things that have big impact. And so if we can change the way we allocate funds, if we change the way we meet, I think we can be pretty effective.
Yeah,
So.
and some of the other liberating structures we've discovered are things like how you communicate, how you assign work, how you allocate your time, and how you build teams. So, rethinking that whole set of activities that are quite common in any organization today, and just doing them in a more agile like way, liberate that structure to serve the purpose of your project. I think it's a very important find, and I'm looking forward to concluding our segment or part on the active agent of change with our guest visitor next week. Erica Wexler will be joining us from Erica Wexler Transforms, a great force in the area of transformation and change. And I think she'll add a lot of context for how we operate in this complex environment of driving organizational change in a meaningful way and keeping the energy alive as we do it. So I'm looking forward to having you join us next week.
Yeah, same here. So stay tuned. See you next week.